Hello there, and welcome to Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration with Krastorio 2. And I have some exciting news. We've finally actually completed the Stargate puzzle. After about, 2 years of playing this one single game in this mod pack, and several weeks now of trying to actually plugging in combinations into the Stargate to try and find how to make this thing work, we've finally made it open up and take us back to where we needed to go. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that, and there's going to be a few spoilers in there. So if you want to make sure you don't actually see anything about the Stargate puzzle, skip forward to the second chapter in the video. You can see the things on the YouTube timeline. But otherwise, we'll get stuck in and have a look at what happened in the last stream. So it turned out that our theory was basically correct. The glyphs all appear on the sphere, as we've been talking about, and then each one has its own triangle, and then when each of those triangles is split up into sub-triangles, which you can find out looking at the other cartouche in each of the pyramids and so on. So we were very much going along the right sort of line to try and find the answer to this problem. And so it was just a case of managing to do the maths accurately enough and work out which triangles we need to look at. And so in the end, we ended up basically going in, doing each step in turn, and then checking it quite carefully to make sure that we were looking at the right triangles and we were in the right place before we then moved on to the next one. So last week I talked about how we'd gone through all of these sets down here and we'd gone in and in and in and in. And you can see how we've got rows of these arrow glyphs for each level we're looking at, and then we go on to it, the next level in, there's one fewer of them, then we look up and then left and then right, and then again in, a bit further in, up, left, right, and so on. And so this was where this worked really, really well, except that we ended up in the wrong place because there were some inaccuracies in there. So in the last stream, Tristan and Mike moved back a little bit further, and then they had to go back a couple of steps back up to here by the looks of it, and then so went back up 3 steps and then back in again, and finally chose the correct glyphs along here and managed to enter them all in. The Stargate opened up to the correct distant destination and it told us we needed to jump in, so they did. Mike managed to miss the Stargate somehow. It's not as if it's particularly small, but somehow he did. But Tristan fell into it, and therefore the victory message popped up in his informatron, and we were able to find out that yes, we'd found the correct destination. We were able to head back home, and we got the standard Factorio win thing that showed us all the stuff we killed in this run, which is an extremely large number of rocks, a few biters, and apparently some fish as well, which is a little bit of a shame, but apparently we did. I don't know whether those are the ones that we actually fished and ate, or whether they were ones that were killed by pollution or explosions. I don't know, but so we've now actually managed to finish the game, which I feel is quite an achievement. I shall go through how we managed to solve the Stargate puzzle in a lot more detail in an upcoming video that'll come out in probably a few weeks, once I've had time to sort of script the whole thing properly and make the video and make sure I get all of the information in there that's needed. But that'll be coming out in a little while, so if you want a bit more information, you can either look back at previous videos where I've talked quite a lot about our methodology, or you can wait for that one to come out as a sort of a summary of all of the summaries. And so, having completed the game in one way, we decided the next logical thing was to try and complete it in the other way as well. And in space exploration, there are 2 ways of finishing the game. You can either solve the Stargate puzzle, or you can build the victory ship. And a victory ship is a ship that's able to travel extremely fast for an extremely long distance. And it tells us in here in the research tree, when you unlock the spaceship victory research, you can unlock the spaceship with the victory condition. We have to make a ship that has an integrity of at least 2500, it has to have a nexus running in distortion drive mode, and it has to be going at a speed of 250 for 600 seconds in interstellar space, as you can see up there. And that means that you have to build a ship that is big, it has to be fast, it has to be able to fly at that speed for quite a long time, and it has to be able to generate an enormous amount of power, because running the Nexus in distortion drive mode uses an enormous amount of power. As it says here, running the Nexus in distortion drive mode uses 6 gigawatts, and that's a lot of power to be producing in a spaceship. And so that's another thing we wanted to work on. However, in K2, if you're playing with K2 as well as SE, in order to unlock the spaceship victory research, you also have to do the intergalactic transceiver and turn it on. And so we deliberately not done these ones because we didn't want to risk having some sort of something pop up and have our first victory not be the Stargate one. So we waited until we'd done the Stargate before starting on these, which in hindsight maybe a slight mistake, but not too serious one. So we also did the intergalactic transceiver research, and that allowed us to then build an intergalactic transceiver, which is what this assembly machine here is for. It's not programmed at the moment because we built one and one was enough, thank you very much, we don't need any more than that. But in order to get that up and running, we also had a couple of machines over here that are making the immersion beams because we needed a huge number of those, and you can tell how long it took because we got a bit fed up and we stuck speed 6 modules in absolutely everything around here just to try and make it run that little bit faster. And so that allowed us to make an intergalactic transceiver, and as you can see in here, they take quite a long time to build, about 10 minutes apparently, which, again, why we had so many speed modules, and it takes 60 gigawatts to run the thing, and it will charge up to 30 terajoules, so that again takes quite a long time, and also a lot of power. So we thought, okay, well, I'll just stick it in here, because I might as well, it's nice and convenient for where it's been made. But unfortunately, in Norbit, we only had 90 gigawatts available, and we were using about 40 of them. This has dropped down, this has gone up, and this has gone down since we were actually looking at it, and so we didn't have enough power available. So I started upgrading some of the solar panels here, which is why we now have 100 gigawatts available. And you can see this sort of mess down here of partial upgrades, where we've upgraded a load of the previous holmium ones to naquium ones, which produce twice as much power. So the area that's been upgraded is now producing twice as much power as it did before. And also, I started building some more of the holmium ones, because we didn't have enough of the naquium ones right up at the top here. So we have a lot of solar here. So I started putting out some scaffolding to put the solar panels in on. And then we decided to change our minds a bit. So, which is why we've got this sort of slightly broken area up here where the scaffolding never got finished. Because I stopped this build from running because I think somebody else needed the bots for something else that was being built. So I didn't want to hog them all just trying to build out an area that we weren't going to use. Mike then started being rather cryptic and suggesting that maybe we should worry a little bit about where we put the transceiver. And so at that point I got a little bit paranoid and went, okay, well, we don't really want to put it up in Norbit just in case something unfortunate happens. Mike suggested we should stick it down on Norvis, and he suggested putting it in, I think, about here, somewhere around here, which I suspect is his attempt to just sort of be difficult and trollish and so on. But we could tell by the sort of the noises he was making that that probably wasn't a very good idea. And so we decided that the best thing to do would be to go out to one of the random orbits where we put in a dimensional anchor, because those have already got absolutely huge quantities of solar available. And the state of these panels might be a little bit of a spoiler, but we'll get to that in a moment. So yes, we decided I'd fly out here with the transceiver, pull up the dimensional anchor, and drop the transceiver in its place, because they use almost exactly the same amount of power. So I dropped it in here and turned it on, and well, you can see what happened. Fortunately, while it was an absolutely enormous explosion, and you can see how big it was by how far out the damage goes, it didn't do a huge amount of damage. All we lost to that was 4 solar panels and the loudspeaker up here, and we very nearly lost this pylon as well. But basically, it wasn't too bad. We're still in quite a good position here. However, if we had put that in Norbit or on Norvis, there'd probably been a certain amount of cleanup to do. Now, okay, the bots would have done it all. It wouldn't really matter, but it would have been a certain amount of cleanup that would have been required. Interestingly, it also wiped all of our inventories. And so because we were all in NavSat mode, because we were watching to see what would happen, I'd got back in my spaceship and blasted off to the minimum safe distance, should we say. Because we were all sitting here watching it through NavSat, it meant we didn't actually lose any inventory items. However, some of the blueprints that I'd created and were storing in my toolbars down here disappeared, and also all the cables and things that were up in my NavSat inventory disappeared as well. So I can put them back in again now, like this, sure. So I can now start making green and red cables again, and that's free. But it was slightly weird that they got deleted, and presumably that means if you weren't playing space exploration, if you're just playing K2, even if you ran away to sort of minimum safe distance before you turned it on, you'd still lose all of your stuff, and that seems a little bit mean, but never mind. The other notable thing about the transceiver is it felt like it took absolutely ages to charge up. Now, okay, granted, we're running at 30 UPS, so everything takes absolutely ages to do anything at all, but this was a surprisingly long time. I suppose it is, as it said on the description, capable of storing 30 terajoules, so that means it would take about 500 seconds to charge, or 1,000 seconds because we're running at half speed, which is more than a quarter of an hour of real time, so you can see why we're getting a little bit grumpy by just how long it took to get ready to power up. But, oh well, never mind. We were quite close to the end at this point, so it didn't matter too much. And it gave Mike a chance to get started on his victory ship. So the victory ship was an interesting one. Originally, we started off using our old Nexus ship as a base, which has which was reasonably specced. We had something like, I think it was 22 engines across the back of here, and then 6 of these antimatter reactors with another 6 high-temperature heat exchangers and the 3 high-temperature turbine generators on the side there, and some condenser turbines as well. And so that's capable of producing about 3 gigawatts from there, and quite a lot of speed from here. And so Mike had gone off, he'd done a bit of testing, he discovered that the Nexus ship was capable of flying at the 250 speed required, so that was pretty good. And it had already had a Nexus on it, again, quite convenient. And then so he got to the point of actually then trying to test it with the Nexus in distortion drive, and then realised that he'd completely forgotten that it requires an additional 6 gigawatts in order to power the Nexus. And so he decided, okay, well, I'll just make the spaceship a bit bigger. So he took the power generation system we had here, and he doubled it. So he put in a second copy of it above, in this area here in the ship. So it was now twice as big, twice the power, and that was very nearly enough power. Because 6 high temperature turbine generators will produce the 6 gigawatts that's required, and the condenser turbines on the side, well, they'll produce a bit of power as well, and that was just about enough to more or less kind of keep the engines going. I think it was borderline. It wasn't really enough, but it was sort of fairly close. The problem is, you also need to keep all of these lasers running and all the shield projectors running in order to keep the ship safe from the number of asteroids it's going to hit when it's travelling at a speed of 250. And that's a lot. You're going to have a lot hitting it. That didn't really work, and so the obvious thing to do then was to put in an additional set of turbines and so on. However, I think he'd already discovered by that point that doubling almost doubling the size of the ship and putting in all of the extra power generation meant that it was no longer capable of doing a speed of 250, and therefore he's going to need more engines. And so I flew out to join him and to lend a bit of a hand. I had a second spaceship that there was an identical copy of the Nexus ship. So I parked that next to it, and we bolted the two of them together in the middle like this, and had a bit of a think about it. But the problem was, there were multiple problems here. Now, it did have enough power because we had the two copies of the power generation system, this one and this one, which has since been moved over to the right a bit. Had those ones over here that were able to produce 6 gigawatts, and then another 3 over here that could take up to 9. However, bolting these two together took us way over the hull stress we had available. So we were at about 5,500, I think, out of the 4,000 we were allowed to do. And so the ship was just too big. It didn't work at all. It also had a really, really poor streamlining score, because it had one section of front that went up and down like that, and then there was sort of a dip in the middle, and another section of front that went up and down like this at a lower level. So it was a very funny shape, and also very, very... Not not particularly streamlined, should we say. So that didn't really work, and we had to more or less abandon that idea. Then we decided that we'd try and continue to Frankenstein the two ships together. So we ended up with this thing you see in front of you now, which is basically all of the components of those two ships. We've adjusted the front of the ship to be this sort of reasonably good triangle shape, although that said, we are still getting a streamlining of only 84%. However, we now have a huge number of engines across the back here. As you can see, we now have 42 engines. Because we trimmed one off each end of it, so it's gone from 44 down to 42. And that, combined with digging all these holes in the middle of it to let some extra space through, has brought our hull stress level down to just under 5,000. So, I mean, that's obviously still more than 4,000. It's still not actually okay, but it's significantly better than we were before. That means we only need to do 2 factory spaceship researches in order to get the ship actually able to fly. And we are cautiously optimistic that the amount of thrust we've got on the back of here with all of these engines is going to be enough to drive the ship through space at faster than 250. It's not certain, but I think our chances are pretty good, and I think it should be okay. It also looks a little bit neater than my victory ship from 0.5 did, because that one, I think, I can't remember what hull stress I was working with there, but I definitely did a lot of fiddling with it to try and keep it under the next hull stress level up from whatever it was at, and so it was a bit of a funny shape. There are a lot of weird holes in it, but you usually get this sort of house-shaped block out of these things, I think, anyway. The other thing you can do is have some engines hanging over, so you have a longer, thinner ship, which will get you a bit more streamlining and much less of a blunt front end, and therefore less space you need to defend, and then have sort of engines hanging off the side, like sort of side pod thrusters. I think they lose a little bit of effectiveness because they'll have something else behind them, but still they still work quite effectively and are definitely better than nothing. The hardest part to fit in is definitely all of the power generation, though, so which we've done here. However, we've probably gone a bit over the top. I suspect that having 7 gigawatts would have been fine, which would potentially have enabled us to make the ship a little bit smaller and maybe a little bit more streamlined, just generally a little bit better. However, yeah, this will probably work. We'll just have to wait and see. So once we managed to get the ship running and fly it off and get the Starship victory, then we will have essentially had sort of 3 victory conditions in a way, because we'll have managed the Stargate victory first, then we'll have managed the K2 victory, which doesn't entirely count because it's not a proper win condition, it's just a step on the way to getting the getting your victory ship, sure, but it sort of counts a little bit, and then we'll get the victory ship as well, and that's going to have to happen next time. So in the next stream, which isn't going to be next week, but it's going to be the week after because 2 of us are away on holiday, we're going to be doing a bit of a retrospective where we're going to be having a look back over how everything went with K2SE, all of our streams, and sort of and reminiscing about it, talking about how things went, what we could have done differently, what we think we should have done differently, what we think we did well, what made sense, and so on, all of that sort of stuff. And so we'd like to get any questions from the viewers as well. So if you have any thoughts you'd like us to mull over, or any questions for us, or anything like that, please stick them in the comments for this video. I'll add them to the list of things we want to talk about, and we'll give it a discussion in the stream, and that'll be on the 29th, I believe. So yeah, please come along then, and we'll have a good chat through it, and to talk about everything that's been going on. There is some other stuff I need to talk about as well, other things that went on during the last stream, but I think this video is probably a reasonable length at this point. I'll try and bring one out tomorrow, but I've got a very busy weekend, so I'm not sure if that's going to happen. I'll do my best though. If not, it'll come out probably the weekend after. So yeah, keep an eye out for it. It should be out before the next stream anyway. As I say, there will be no videos or streams next week because I shall be away on holiday. But the week after, we will have the retrospective stream and also finishing off this weird Frankenship here on Monday the 29th, followed by another satisfactory stream on the Wednesday after, which will be the usual sort of carrying on trying to get everything running fast enough to produce all of the resources that I need to finish that game as well. So after that, I'm then going to need to start thinking about some new games to play. I do have a few ideas, but again, if you have any suggestions, please chuck them in the comments and I'll add them to the list of things I'm considering. I do have a few ideas that will probably be coming in first, but I am always interested in new things to play. So thank you very much for watching, I hope you've enjoyed the video, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.